heavy vehicle regulator. Liz has a great history, I think, going back to Peter Sweatman days with road user research, is that correct? And moving on through various agencies, National Transport Commission, National Heavy Vehicle Regulator, Queensland Transport. You've done it all, Liz. And it's been a theme through all of it. It's been about productivity in heavy vehicles. And so Liz is probably one of the preeminent technical people in Australia who has written the PBS agenda now for 10 years or more. He and I were lucky enough to be involved in the startup of the PBS process in the what's called the PRP, the PBS Review Panel. Interim Review Panel, thank you, Liz. For 2.5 years, we did the first 80 PBS approvals. I think they're all still on my computer if anyone wants them. So we've got the right person in the room, and Liz is going to give us a presentation on PBS and its impact on the truck and trailer marketplace. So it's basically about how much penetration by the various types of equipment that you've achieved. So I'm going to hand the microphone to you and try and get your presentation up.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I'm always lucky to get the last presentation slot of the day, or one after lunch, or the first one. So, thank you very much for the introduction, and thanks for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here, and I would like to congratulate ARTSA for organizing this and all the work what they are doing in the data area. This afternoon I would like to talk about some of the PBS trends and what we can notice after a few years of the introduction of this scheme of framework, but I wasn't sure if in the audience everybody was familiar with PBS or not, so I don't want to cover PBS too much, but for those of you who are not familiar with the scheme, I have a few slides just summarizing what PBS is all about. And this slide shows heavy vehicles, and this was raised in, I think, Peter's presentation in terms of the categories, because these are important when we are looking at heavy vehicle data. So these are, in terms of the low, everything above 4.5 tons would be classified as a heavy vehicle. Those are the freight vehicles, but also the special purpose vehicles, low loaders and all the other things. In terms of the fleet, before PBS was introduced until the middle of the 90s, these were the conventional heavy vehicle classes around the country. So prime mover semi-trailers, VWs, different rotating combinations in certain jurisdictions. These represented the majority of the fleet. And then we moved away from, we were thinking to develop a scheme which would move away from prescriptive regulations. And obviously the demands for increased freight task on the transport industry was there. So the idea came, how about if we try to develop a system which is a little bit different? And that was when PBS was born, where we are trying to describe how the vehicle performs on the road instead of just regulating the sizes of different vehicle combinations in terms of length, width, mass, overall height, and so on. So PBS, an alternative regulatory system, but it's special now because it's part of the national heavy vehicle law. And Australia is leading the world in that sense because we are the only country which would have a PBS, a fully PBS-based regulation for heavy vehicles. If Rob was talking about that it's been a long time, and yes, originally, if I look at the history, NTC commenced this project back in 1999 with all those beautiful sort of principles that making the road transport more efficient and innovative, reducing environmental impacts, reducing administrative costs, and those principles are still valid for the transport system 70 years later. In 2001, the ATC endorsed the policy framework for PBS, and in 2003, they approved an interim framework for PBS. 2003 was a big year, significant, because that was when the 20 performance measures were established or selected after a complete assessment of the fleet back then, which included the computer simulation and assessment of more than 139 heavy vehicle combinations. But this is a long process, and then, as Rob mentioned, in 2005, that was when the first interim regulatory panel was established, and then 2006 and 2007, that these were the years when the things really started to happen, and the package was approved and endorsed by transport ministers in 2007. So strictly speaking, we have a framework, a PBS framework, since 2007. 2011, we had a RIS, and in 2013, when the beloved National Heavy Regulator was established, we took over the management of the framework, and in 2014 was the year when it was incorporated and included in the national law. There are some achievements that in May 2016, so this year, just a few months ago, we released the first PBS notice in this country, and just yesterday we finished the 42nd meeting of the performance review panel, which is basically looking at all PBS applications in this country. So that's the short history. So in terms of the process, we've got PBS assessors, we've got a few of those here who are assessing vehicle concepts using computer simulations against certain standards, and then they send an application to the National Heavy Regulator. We review those and talk to the performance review panel, ask them for their advice, and then the combinations are approved. And then when the vehicles are built, there is another process when the vehicles have to be certified. So there are independent PBS certifiers who are checking if the vehicles are built to the specification which was approved. And I guess we are getting to the data phase because this is the important element. So all PBS vehicles in this country, all and every one of them are going through a certification process, which means that we have all that information for the PBS approved combinations. In terms of their operation, they can be operated by an notice or individual permit. This chart shows the PBS experience in terms of the number of applications, and starting in January 2008 up to July 2016. And you can see that there is a significant increase in terms of new applications. In terms of the design approvals, so after the application, we have to issue a design approval that provides the approval for a manufacturer to build a PBS vehicle. So in terms of the design approvals, here are the numbers. You can see that those numbers are relatively constant. So after an initial sort of growth in the new applications, now we see a plateauing sort of effect. So we've got manufacturers, most of them would have a number of blueprint or approved concept vehicles what they can offer to their clients. If we look at the vehicle approvals, so that's the actual document what we issue after the certification, that chart shows the increase. And you can see that that's a continuous growth, roughly between 20 and 30% per year, which shows that the industry is taking up PBS vehicle options. Now, if we put all those together, that's the workload of my little team, and you can see that that's a significant increase. And the two major sort of points in time from our perspective, and that's February 2013 when we took over the management of the scheme, and then February 2014 when the National Heavy Vehicle Law was introduced. Obviously, we had a bumpy start, and I remember the conference here when I was getting significant criticism from the audience in terms of how we were conducting our business, but those days have come. Fortunately, we can provide much better service to the industry. So what are the PBS examples? I'm going to go through very quickly those slides because these are just examples, but I thought that some of the people would need to understand which are the combinations what we are talking about in our database. So these are 90 meter truck and dog, and that's very similar to a prescriptive vehicle, 3-axle truck, 4-axle dog. You can see some of the messes there. Then we've got the 4-axle dog. These are normally these days 20 meters long, with some increased masses. What was a big step for these combinations that previously these combinations didn't operate on different networks, so they weren't allowed to operate. And we've got another version, so it's mainly truck and dog. This is a 5-axle dog, so it's a 3-axle truck, 5-axle dog. You can see that the masses there are increasing, and also normally the length of the combination is increasing as well. Then we've got the bigger ones, the 6-axle dog, so 3-axle truck, 6-axle dog. These are up to the B-double mass limits and provide a very flexible option for some of the industry segments. 20 meter long prime mover semi, that's another very popular vehicle, mainly volume based operations. They provide extra 15-20% productivity improvement in terms of the volume what they can carry. Then quad-axle semi trailers, those are for the heavier freight tasks. Again, on the PBS, they could be approved with 20 meters length. And then we get to another probably conventional vehicle, which is the B double. What we see in PBS that there are applications or applicants who want to operate these vehicles with increased height. Under prescriptive regulations, if you exceed the 4.3 meter height limit, you have to reduce the GCM. Under PBS, that reduction doesn't valid anymore, so they can get again around 15% improvement in productivity. And if we get to the larger vehicles, and probably that's one of the biggest success combination, a 30 meter long PBS A double, which looks like a conventional road train, but these vehicles provide real productivity improvements. And you might see these vehicles in more urban areas around the country. Initially, these vehicles were introduced in Queensland, in Brisbane, between the port and Toowoomba, but now other jurisdictions, Melbourne has them, and also New South Wales is introducing them in bigger numbers. There are different versions of that container carrying or park vehicles. And that's, we are getting to the longer vehicles, that's 36 and a half meter long AV triple. So after this short introduction, what are the vehicle approvals what we issue? And we put up the data there for the last 3 years. So you can see that the 3-axle truck, 4-axle dog combination was the most popular within the last 3 years. We've got Prelimover semis, B doubles, and then the smaller truck and dogs as well. But the main focus was on this vehicle class, the 3-axle truck, 4-axle dog. And it's interesting that basically that's the class what Peter and Andrew were talking about before lunch, where there is, you can see a significant activity and increased registration numbers. If we look at the states, and I just put this slide up because when we are looking at the ARTSA data, and I'm going to talk about that shortly, obviously the registration data includes registration figures from WA and the Northern Territory as well. Those states are not really active in PBS, and you can see that most of the PBS combinations are coming from Victoria, Queensland, and New South Wales. Those are the main jurisdictions when PBS vehicles are operated. We had, I think, one approval for WA and none for the Northern Territory. So when we are looking at the registration data, we have to filter those to a certain extent because previous vehicles are not running there. Before I get to the data, there are a few sort of clarifications what I would like to make. That, as I mentioned, all vehicles or units have to have a PBS certification, so therefore it's a good source of information. We are using WIN data, and in our case, we don't have the limitations what ARTSA has, because we've got the full 17 digits which would describe the unit. But there are some issues with that, because some manufacturers are not using the same sort of description for the vehicles. So in those cases, we are trying to use some additional sources to clarify the information. There is a difficulty in identifying the larger combinations because, for instance, a semi-trailer could be used in a number of combinations. So it could be used in a shorter one and could be used for a larger road train. And operators these days are developing logistical solutions for their operation, which might include a number of PBS vehicle options, starting with a shorter one, going for a larger one. In 2014, there was an Ostrux report which looked at the potential benefits of PBS and innovative combinations. And it suggested that it would provide huge $6.9 billion productivity benefits to the country, 60-70% reduction in crash rates, and significant environmental savings. But that was based on a certain take-up rate. It was based on the assumption that vehicles will get access to the networks and industry would be able to operate PBS vehicles. Currently, the NTC is running a project to review the PBS framework, and these numbers are used in their work as well. You can see the number of PBS combinations approved in those years. You can see that the first two years it was just a very small number, and the numbers increased significantly. In this year, we predict that we're going to have more than 1,200 combinations approved based on the data what we have up to date. So for 2015, and this is where we tried to look at trends, we approved the 915 combinations with 3,816 individual units. And you can see that, as I mentioned, 3XO truck, 4XO dope, that was the dominant combination. In 2016, we are with 945 combinations with 3,251 individual units. The truck and docks are still representing the biggest sort of percentage, but you can see an increased number of B-doubles and other combinations in the mix. When we are trying to identify the units, that's where I just would like to describe you the complexity. So on these charts, you can see on the left hand, you can see the vehicle combinations in 2016. And those are the combinations which were added, which are on the vehicle approval. Now, this is the latest data, so there are some differences between the figures of the charts. Forgive me, that's based on when the actual data was produced. So you can see that we had 68 A-double combinations, and on those approvals we had 592 individual units, individual VIN numbers on those approvals. And if you go down to the table on the left, you can see that let's say if we look at A doubles, we had 189 prime movers, 166 leads for first trailers, 8 trailers for first trailers, 131 dollies, and 106 rear trailers or second trailer on the combination. So sometimes it's difficult to identify which are the brand new units and which are units which have been registered before. And I guess this is probably the most important chart of my presentation. So we had the opportunity to have access to the database what Peter and Andrew are using. And what we tried to do, we tried to identify the PBS units in new registration. So now I'm talking about the same 6 months what they presented for you before lunch. And here are four vehicle classes, 3XO. These are all 3XO trucks, or basically the truck part doesn't matter. These are 3XO dock trailers, 4XO dock trailers, 5XO dock trailers, and 6XO dock trailers. So four trailer types which were shown before, and you can see that 92% of the new trailers registered this year were PBS trailers. So, and that's a significant step forward in terms of PBS. And you can see that 5 exodocs, it's 68, 6 exodocs, it's around 20. I would say that this figure would be significantly higher if I would just use registration data for the eastern states, because that includes WA, where the 6 exodoc trailers are extremely popular. Obviously, in the 3 exodoc category, the penetration is not that high, but that's probably could be explained with the fact that they don't get that much productivity improvement if they are operating under PBS. So that's a surprising. I was really surprised to see these figures. But it means that PBS is now in the mainframe of the industry in certain vehicle categories. We can also look at similar sort of statistics what Peter was talking about, and obviously for PBS fleets, these are newer vehicles, and this is the hauling unit, so it's not just trucks, it's also prime movers included in these statistics, and you can see again the age of those units, truck and dock combinations and others, and roughly 78% of the combinations would be built between 2010 and 2016. So PBS vehicles are normally representing newer vehicles, and that's probably not a surprise. Here is the same graph for trailers, and the trend is really similar to the prime or to the hauling units, and I guess that's probably because around 2010, 2011, that was when PBS really started to buy, and you can see that we have the highest percentage of newer units in this class as well. The take-up rates are very interesting, and it's very difficult to predict where we're going to go with these vehicles. In 2001, NTC predicted that we're going to have probably 3,000 new PBS combinations per year after an initial sort of period of time. I think people believe that figure was probably too high, and when the Ostroth review happened in 2014, they tried to look at the growth rates for different classes, and sorry about the size of that chart. Those vehicle types are exactly the same as the registration or the NABDIS data that ARTSA is using. But they were trying to establish what sort of growth scenarios we might get within the next 15, 20 years. And it was obvious that PBS is not for all vehicle classes. We've got a large number of vehicle classes, like big trailers, smaller units, some rigid vehicles, where there won't be any penetration, or it's unlikely that we're going to get penetration by PBS vehicles. So that means that to achieve the penetration rates or take-up rates would depend on what do we look at as a baseline fleet size in terms of the fleet size which would be available for PBS. Strongly influenced by different things. The commercial environment, and we heard a presentation earlier about how demand on certain sectors would be changing, and that would influence the take-up rates for certain PBS combinations. But also practices. We have developed a number of very efficient PBS vehicles where, for instance, stevedoring companies weren't prepared to use those vehicles, even that they were much more productive, but they were against, or they were different than the practices what they used at that point in time. The regulatory environment is always a key element. And I guess with the establishment of the National Heavy Vehicle Regulator, it's where we have, and with the fact that now PBS is in the loop, that provides a better regulatory environment. But when we look at that, interesting that even charging decisions can influence what people do, what the industry does. And the recent increases in terms of charging for certain vehicle classes might influence how operators select or choose a vehicle for a given credit class. Access limitations. This conference is not about access, but currently access is the biggest problem for PBS vehicles. And obviously, if we could provide more access for these vehicles, then the take-up rates would increase significantly. Despite all of that, the take-up rates currently for PBS vehicles are significantly exceeding the predictions from 2014. So, in certain sectors, as I mentioned, the take-up rate is very, very high. I showed you before that figure for the dog trailers. If I combine the registration numbers and the PBS approved units for the 3, 4, and 6 axle dogs, the take-up rate is around 78%. So that's really significant. Again, I would like to acknowledge ARTSA contribution and the assistance what we are getting from the data unit. Because it's extremely valuable and a good resource for us to influence PBS data decisions. And I think it's exactly 30 minutes, and that was my last slide. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Liz. Thanks for the acknowledgement. Do you have some questions?
Yes, time on.
Do you have a with do you have a thing in the future looking at widening? I didn't even want to.
Why? No, it's a very good question and very controversial question. The PBS standards don't include any width limit. So the width of the vehicle is limited by performance standards. How much road space they are using when they are turning, how much road space they are using when they are traveling in a straight line, and so on. We have approved a number of vehicles which are wider than 2.5 meters. Just the PRP meeting, thanks to Marcus and the company, we traveled a 2.55 meter wide bus, which is operating up in Brisbane. But we received a number of applications from different sectors, including refrigerated operators, and also operators carrying specific freight tasks like special containers and so on. With those vehicles, normally there's no problem with those vehicles achieving or meeting the PBS standards. It's normally the access which would restrict the wider penetration of wider vehicles. And road managers are really concerned about it. There are conflicting demands on road managers, and we have to acknowledge that, especially in urban areas, in terms of bicycle lanes and parking, and trying to increase the number of lanes for certain pieces of infrastructure. So, but I believe that it's going to happen. And a lot of people would say that PBS is probably a good first step, which would be the start before a full national review might happen and make a decision about the acceptable way for those vehicles.
No other questions?
So, other prime movers, Andrew, remind me, how many, in the last 12 months, how many multi-combination prime movers were registered? 3,200?
About that. There were about 5,000 prime movers in total, and about, a bit over 3,000 were multi-combination. So
how many PBS combinations in the multi-combs are level 2,200?
I think that that would be a relatively small number, and there are a couple of reasons behind it. First, that in some of the more innovative states or states which used to be innovative, like Queensland, they transferred most of the innovative combinations into a prescriptive regime. So that means they don't have to go through a PBS assessment. In terms of WA and the Northern Territory, they approved those combinations again under the prescriptive system, a part of a few really special ones. So we don't see those. So it's only mainly South Australia, New South Wales, and Victoria where we see more multi-combinations, but those are relatively the smaller units. So the number of prime movers in those combinations would be relatively small.
On my roll here, the pre-existing approvals, the manufacturer's approvals that you spoke of, how does that work? So is that an attempt to sort of separate trucks from trailers, that the prime mover can be treated separately from the trailer? How does that work?
When the PBS review last time happened in 2014, for the reason it was part of the regulatory impact statement, that was one of the suggestions that we should have some sort of modular system where you can really separate the hauling unit from trailers. Unfortunately, that's technically complex and that work really hasn't happened. So what we can see as a trend that PBS assessors, like Marcus, they are developing the concepts with really wide ranges, with a number of prime mover options and a number of trailer options. So that means that operators or manufacturers can offer that concept with different vehicle options. I think that's a trend, which makes it probably more complex, but it's a way of working with the limitations.
Yes. And the dog trailer notice, how does that work?
In terms of what?
Well, so you don't need to. There's a notice involved. So it's like a blueprint.
Yeah, basically there are two different sort of concepts in this area. The truck and dog notice, what we released back in May, that's really dealing with the access area. Okay. So that provides automatic access for PBS approved vehicles on approved networks. So that means that operators of those vehicles wouldn't need an individual permit to run a PBS combination. They could run them automatically. The other project, what NTC started some time ago, that was trying to migrate PBS star combinations back into the prescriptive system. So trying to develop blueprint type envelopes and setting up a system where vehicles don't have to go through the assessment process, but they would be able to, operators would be able to operate them without the PBS approval, provided that they meet the specification.
Yes.
That project is slowly going ahead.
Yeah, but that's a sensible outcome of PBS to actually challenge the existing regs and get the regs to change.
Initially, when the PBS framework was developed, that was one of the principles that with PBS and especially influencing how prescriptive regulations are developed, PBS is a very, very good tool, because that means that the general quality of the fleet can be improved and enhanced by using PBS performance principles.
Yes. Thank you.
Can't hear you, mate. Just a question regarding the expansion of the truck and dog.
Yes.
Yeah. Truck and dog notices. When are we going to see A doubles and B doubles and semi trailers included in the similar type notice?
Those are planned. Obviously, the complexity and the willingness of road managers would influence how we can progress those. We are already working on an A double notice, which would cover the operation of A doubles, but also we have already drafted a generic PBS notice, which wouldn't be restricted to vehicle type. It would be just a level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4 type of notice, regardless of the vehicle combination. And that's probably the ultimate sort of goal, to get to that level, that if you have a PBS combination, let's say level 2, then you should be able to operate that combination on level 2 networks without any restriction, regardless if it's a truck and dog or B-level or B-triple or whatever the combination is.
Lastly, what's the NHVR's position on the high productivity vehicle networks in Victoria and, you know, the pre-approved A doubles and super B doubles for certain weights and put out a network, but that's not currently tied into the PBS level 2B network?
I mean, it's a little bit difficult to deal with those sort of policies, because on one hand they are extremely good, and we could mention the special policy in New South Wales regarding to the construction vehicles, the truck and dog, which could be operated on certain level, certain networks with increased masses. The difficulty is, from our perspective, how do you regulate the operation of those vehicles nationally? And that's still probably the key problem with those high productivity vehicle networks, because the mass limits with what Victoria apply for those vehicles are different than some of the mass limits what some other jurisdictions would be using. So it would be, I think it's a good thing that those networks have been established, but probably better if we don't classify them as PBS networks, because then there would be a confusion what the appropriate mass limit is for a certain PBS vehicle. But it's an access, mainly an access related issue, not a vehicle related issue. So,
okay. So we're going to be happy with these hybrid networks, which are
I'm not saying that we are happy. I'm saying that it's a good thing that innovative policies are developed, but I would still believe that those policies should be harmonized between jurisdictions, because that would be beneficial for the for the transport industry, they would have certainty that for a vehicle, what is the mass limit. So if we introduce different policies in different jurisdictions, then we are not working as a national heavy to regulate. It's our aim to synchronize the policies and have uniform rules around the country.
This is related to data, which is probably where I should be pitching questions. PBS permits, you mentioned the design approval and stuff. Have you got any data from the regulator regarding the volume of permits, particularly the volume of permits pre and post, some of the changes that have been made, like the truck and dock notice, and also like the, there's some rule changes that the regulator implemented in July about how they dealt with permit applications.
In terms of the we have access data now, we are monitoring individual access applications, so I don't have that here, but I could look at that. Unfortunately, the introduction of the PBS truck and dog notice wasn't just a positive sort of experience, because it came at the same time when there were some changes in the way our access decisions were made, especially in New South Wales. For other jurisdictions, it was relatively seamless, and we will see differences in terms of number of PBS permits issued for those areas, but probably New South Wales is a little bit different. So I think it's going to take time until we can really see the changes in terms of the impacts of those regulatory sort of tools that we are using for managing access.
Good. Thank you.